Well, as I said, I get to introduce a number of people this weekend, and I'm excited for you to be able to experience our next speaker. I've sat under his teaching several times and have been profoundly blessed every time I hear him speak. Christopher West is a proud husband and father of five. His global lecturing, best-selling books, and multiple audio and video programs have also made him the world's most recognized teacher on John Paul II's Theology of the Body. It's a bold, biblical vision of love and sexuality, and listen to this line, that takes us to the core of what it means to be human. So profound. As founder and president of the Core Project, he leads an international outreach devoted to helping others. Would you please welcome Christopher West?
The Holy Spirit grants the church what she needs when she needs it. Would you agree?
Yes.
The Holy Spirit grants the church what she needs when she needs it. Would you agree that the church today is facing a crisis of a sexual nature? If we look at church history, 2,000 years of men and women following Jesus Christ, crisis, controversy, difficulty, struggle, trial is only something of the 20th century, correct? No. Has been with us from the beginning. Crisis is nothing new. But whenever a crisis afflicts the people of God, whenever a crisis afflicts the church, the Holy Spirit raises a great theological mind to articulate a sound, divinely inspired, biblically based response to the crisis. We are in such an age. And I want to propose to you that the theological mind, one of many, many are raised up. I don't want to just limit it to one. But one great theological mind that has been raised up for the people of God today is a crazy, and I mean that, crazy Polish priest named Karol Wojtyła. Karol Wojtyła, as a young priest in Poland in the 1950s, was recognizing prophetically that a movement was coming in the Western world that would strike a blow at the very foundations of the Christian faith. A movement opposed to God's design for the human body. And he began developing a biblical response to this movement that he saw coming. The sexual revolution was barely underway, but it was beginning to happen, and he saw it coming. And he knew we needed a biblical response to the crisis that was coming. Some 30 years later, nearly 30 years later, this crazy Polish priest just so happened to be elected Pope and took the name John Paul II. I was a young boy in Catholic schools at the time. I had no idea how much this crazy Polish priest, now Pope John Paul II, would change my life. I'd like to frame the conversation in presenting to you this Theology of the Body by John Paul II by telling you a story. There was a young couple madly in love, full of passion and erotic desire. It was a beautiful summer's night, the stars were out, and they decided to drive out into the country to find a quiet hill where they could get a blanket and express their passion for one another under the stars. They drove out of the country, found a quiet spot, grabbed the blanket, went out under the stars, and began to engage in some, shall we say, deep lip lock. Little did they know, they were on the property of a Mennonite church. And the pastor heard a little commotion, looked out his window, saw what was going on, and decided he would go for a prayer walk. Quietly approaching the couple. They were so engaged in what they were doing, they had no idea someone was coming right up to them until... Psst! Staring a Mennonite pastor in the face, this couple thought they would be roundly scolded. But instead, the pastor simply said, "Tell me, what does what you're doing here have to do with the stars? What does what you're doing here have to do with the stars?" The pastor walked back to his home, leaving a couple to ponder that question. And it's the question I want us to ponder this morning. What does erotic desire have to do with the stars? And what do we mean by the stars? The stars are a symbol for us in God's creation of the infinite, of heaven. What does erotic desire have to do with heaven? How many of you were raised in a Christian home? Can I see a show of hands? How many of you would say that in your Christian upbringing there is open, honest, normal, healthy conversation about God's glorious, beautiful, wonderful, stupendous plan for erotic desire? Please raise your hand. One sort of kind of hand went... Okay, we're over 100 people here. Less than 1% of us were raised in Christian homes where anyone connected the dots between erotic desire and heaven. This is a problem. This is a big problem. And I would suggest that that silence in our churches and in our Christian homes, that silence is largely responsible for the sexual revolution. Eros. The Greeks called it eros. The English word erotic has gotten so twisted and distorted by our pornographic culture that we can work and we must work to rehabilitate that word erotic, but it takes a lot of work. Eros is maybe a little more easy for us to enter into because it doesn't have the same kind of connotations in our English language of erotic. But I do want to work to reclaim that word erotic. It's not a bad word. Who created erotic desire?
God.
Are you sure, Anne?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
You're absolutely right. God! God gave us this longing. God gave us this yearning. God gave us this cry of the heart. Turn on the radio and you're going to hear this cry, this hunger, this ache, this longing. You're going to hear it. Maybe Bruce Springsteen said it best. Everybody's got a hungry heart. Right? That hunger, that ache, that cry of the heart for something. It's called eros. And I want to suggest, my brothers and sisters, that that eros that God planted in our bodies and souls on the dawn of our creation when He made us male and female, that God put eros there as like the fuel of a rocket that has the power to launch us to the stars, to launch us to infinity and beyond. But if we all have this hungry heart, if we all have this yearning for infinite love, for infinite satisfaction, for infinite union, we also have to listen to these kind of songs on the radio. Why can't Mick Jagger get no satisfaction? This man tries, and he tries, and he tries, and he tries. But he can't get no satisfaction. Why? Well, if it is a yearning for the infinite, If eros, this erotic longing, this cry of the heart for love and union, is actually a yearning for heaven, for something infinite, if we take that yearning to something finite, is it going to satisfy? But if we're convinced that this finite pleasure is supposed to satisfy, but it doesn't, what do we think we need? More. So we go and we get more. Does it satisfy yet? So we go and we get more. Does it satisfy yet? So we go and we get more. Does it satisfy yet? That is a life not of happiness and fulfillment. That is a life of addiction. Can I suggest a theological definition of addiction? Not a psychological one, but a theological one. Here it is. Addiction happens when we take our yearning for the infinite to something finite. That's why Mick Jagger can't get no satisfaction. Now, I don't know about you, but I love the pleasures of this world. Who made them? God. And God looked at everything He made and said, "Behold, it is very good." Have you ever pondered the miracle of taste buds? I love to eat. I love to eat. Don't you love to eat? Come on, just be honest. Don't you love to eat? Eating is one of the most brilliant pleasures of planet Earth, right? God made it. I love to eat so much that at the end of a good meal, I'm sad. Why am I sad? Because it's over. It's done. It's over. Now, right in that sadness, it seems to me I have three choices. Right in that sadness, I can pretend I'm not sad, and I can repress what's really going on in my heart. That's the life of a stoic, not a Christian. Christians are the ones who delight properly, keyword, delight properly in the pleasures of this world. Delight properly. Now, I could also, at the end of that meal and in my sadness, I could go back for more, but guess what's going to happen then? I'm going to be sad when that's over, so I'll go back for more. So we have, on the one hand, I can be a stoic, or I can be an addict. Or, I want to suggest, we can all be, in the Christian sense of the word, we can be aspiring mystics. Many people confuse Christianity with that stoic approach. Food is bad. Food is evil. Pleasures are evil. And we run away from them because they can be, admittedly and honestly, they can be an occasion of sin. The very thing that can be an occasion of virtue can be an occasion of sin. That food, the pleasure of that food, and the sadness at the end of the pleasure, if I'm looking at it with God's own heart, I will see and I will feel in my being that sadness is an indication that I am made, I am designed, I am created for a feast that never ends. I'm created for an infinite feast, an infinite satisfaction of that hunger. And God gave me the gift of this delicious meal to be a little glimmer, a sign. A sign here on planet Earth that's meant to point me to heaven. And when I understand the pleasures of this world, all of them, whether food or sex or music or the beauty of a sunset, all the pleasures and good things God created, which is everything because God looked at everything He made and said, "Behold, it is very good." All the pleasures of this world are so many little icons that are meant to point me to heaven. But when I direct my desire for heaven towards the icon of heaven, the icon becomes an idol. An idol. It's a God substitute. But behind every God substitute is the desire for the real God that's gotten misdirected. Are you following me? How did Paul evangelize Athens? What did he do? He studied very... Read the Acts of the Apostles. It's right there. He studied their idols very carefully. He studied their idols very carefully. And if the historians are correct, the idols of the Greeks 2,000 years ago, the same idols we have today, there's nothing new under the sun. They didn't have photography 2,000 years ago, but what did they have? Sculpture. So these sculptures, the historians tell us, were of a pornographic nature. And so it makes sense when we read in Scripture that Paul says, the Scripture says of Paul, he was deeply disturbed by their idols. And so he marched into Athens with indignation and condemned them all and told them they're all going to hell because of their idolatry, right? Wrong. First words out of Paul's mouth to these idolaters. You know what he said to them? I see you are a very religious people. I see you are a very religious people. Our culture today is worshiping sex. More specifically, it's worshiping the pleasure of sex. But can we look at the world and look at our own hearts and look at our own false worship and recognize behind the disordered worship is actually the desire for the stars? But our rocket engines got pointed towards something that can't possibly satisfy us. If God gave us erotic desire to be like the fuel of a rocket that's meant to launch us to the stars, what would happen if those rocket engines became inverted? No longer pointing us heavenward, but pointing back on ourselves, pointing towards something finite. What's going to happen if you set off that rocket? Blast of self-destruction. That's what's going on in our culture of death. Jesus comes into the world not to condemn the rocket, not to tell us to reject the pleasures of this world. He comes into this world to redirect our rocket engines towards the stars. This is the gift of our redemption. And this is the gift I discovered in this crazy Polish priest teaching called Theology of the Body. We all have this hunger, but 99% of us are raised on a starvation diet. We're told basically the thing that's hovering in the air in a lot of Christian homes and a lot of Christian churches, all the silence, the taboo around this subject, the translation of that is basically this. Your desires are bad. They're only going to get you in trouble. You need to deny them, repress them, annihilate them, somehow ignore them, but follow all these rules and then you'll be a good, upstanding Christian citizen. If that's Christianity, I don't want anything to do with it. Do you want anything to do with that? I tried to follow the rules, didn't you? Did it work? For a time, maybe it works. We can put on a mask and we can pretend we're getting our act together, but inside, am I right? I'm hungry. I don't know about you. I'm hungry. I'm hungry, and I mean that in the deeper, wider sense. I'm looking for something. I'll never forget the first time I felt this ache, this cry for something infinite. I was 8 years old. I'm lying in my bed, and I'm listening to the radio, and Springsteen comes on singing Born to Run. I didn't know what he was singing about, but I knew he had some cosmic cry in his heart, and I felt it too. He's talking about this place he wants to go. He's looking for something. He's running towards something. He says to this woman, her name in the song is Wendy. This song is a prophecy of my whole life because I married a woman named Wendy. So he says to Wendy, someday, girl, I don't know when, we're going to get to that place where we really want to go. And we'll walk in the sun. Do you hear that? Do you hear the cry of the heart there? He knows he's created for something. He's looking for it, and he's looking for it with her. Someday, girl, I don't know when, we're going to get to this place where we really want to go, and we'll walk in the sun. But till then, tramps like us, baby, we were born to run. Right in the Song of Songs, come away with me, let us run. Come away with me, let us run. And then Springsteen, at the end of the song, he just opens his rib cage and this cry came out. I'm 8 years old and I hear this cry. If you'll permit me, it went something like this. Whoa, oh, 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 whoa, 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 oh, 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 something rumbled through my soul. It's like the sky split open. And God poured out. And I knew whatever Springsteen wanted, I wanted to. I wanted to get to this place. I wanted to run to it. Tragedy in my Christian upbringing, nobody connected the dots for me between that cry of my heart, which is called Eros. It's called Eros. Nobody connected the dots between that cry of my heart and what I was learning in Bible school. In fact, I was basically given the impression that that cry of my heart had to be squashed if I wanted to be good. And when you're raised on that starvation approach to the hunger, follow the rules, squelch the desire. When that's the approach, no wonder the culture's fast food gospel starts to look so attractive. The culture knows we are creatures of passion and desire. The culture knows we have these erotic longings, and the culture, in a very expert kind of way, I might add, knows how to awaken these desires. But it's always a bait and switch. The desire for the infinite gets awakened, and then it gets directed towards something finite. And we are guaranteed satisfaction for three easy payments of $19.95. Satisfaction guaranteed. So we lay down our three payments because we're all looking for satisfaction. And they said it was guaranteed. But if it's a yearning for the infinite, there's nothing in this world that can satisfy. So I ate this fast food. Because it's better than the starvation diet. Come on, let's be honest. If the only two choices for the hunger are starvation on the one hand or fast food on the other, I don't know about you, but I'm going for the nuggets. Because I am hungry. I'm a hungry creature. And don't tell me those nuggets don't taste good. They do. Especially when you're really hungry. Those nuggets taste good. There is a semblance. Keyword, semblance of satisfaction in eating the fast food. But if you do that for enough time, like I did, you're going to end up like the guy in the movie Super Size Me. Everybody seen that? Documentary of a guy who eats McDonald's breakfast, lunch, and dinner for 30 days. At the end of this little experiment, he was literally dying. Goes to the doctor, gets all these tests. The doctor says, you're dying from all the grease and sodium. That's a picture of me in my college years, having eaten so much grease and sodium, so to speak, I was dying inside. Had the tragic experience as a freshman in college, this would be now the late 80s, had the tragic experience of witnessing a date rape in a college dorm. And this experience haunted me. And it compelled me to ask some very big questions about life, about love, about sex, about erotic desire. I was furious at this guy who had just treated this woman as a non-person, just used her for his own selfish pleasure. And the more furious I was at him, the more I knew I needed to hold a mirror up to myself and say, am I much different? When I'm with my girlfriend, it's not a matter of date rape, but am I loving her? I don't know. What's love? Am I using her just like I saw this guy do? Probably. And I was mad. I was angry. I was a restless, angry young man. My father, who's here, said to me once when I was a teenager, "You're a very angry young man." And I said, "No, I'm not." Where does anger come from? I would like to suggest that anger comes from unfulfilled desire. Anger comes from a kind of hopelessness, a kind of sense of futility, that I have all these desires and there's nothing. I was a very angry young man because I had all these desires and I did not know what to do with them. And what the world was telling me to do with them, and what my Christian upbringing was telling me to do with them, starvation on the one hand and fast food on the other, neither was bringing happiness. Both brought death. You can die of starvation, and you can die of food poisoning. Are you following me? So what do we do with the ache? What do we do with the hunger? I remember getting on my knees. It's 1988. I'm in a college dorm, and this ragged prayer came out that was ugly on the one hand and beautiful on the other. And it went something like this: "God in heaven, if you exist, you better show me, and you better show me why you gave me all these desires, because they're getting me and everybody I know into a hell of a lot of trouble. What is your design for my desire? Do you have a plan?" 12 years of Catholic school wasn't useless. There was a voice that went something like this. I heard it: "Seek, and you will find. Seek, and you will find." And I sought, and I sought, and I sought. Long story short, 1993, I discovered something called the Theology of the Body, a collection of 129 short talks that this crazy Polish priest delivered between 1979 and 1984. Coincidentally, right at the time I was going through puberty. And I don't know how this crazy Polish guy did it, but he put his finger right on it in my heart, and I felt like he was talking to me. Now, this is some dense scholarship, by the way. I give these talks around the world about theology of the body, and people get excited, and they go out, and they get this work called Theology of the Body, which I introduced Andrew to in, 1998 or something. And you need a theological dictionary and a philosophical dictionary to understand what he's even talking about. Some really dense stuff. It's 2,000 years worth of Christian reflection on the meaning of our creation as male and female. Nonetheless, I had a gift to get it. And I felt like he was talking right to me. And for the first time in my life, I had somebody say to me, "Christopher, that erotic cry of your heart is good. God put it there to lead you to Him. It's a desire for the infinite. And if you think Christianity is all about squashing that, then you are confusing Christianity with a heresy called Manichaeism, called Gnosticism, called Puritanism, that thinks the body and sex is bad and evil and needs to be squashed and crushed and rejected." He said, "This is not Christianity." He said to me in so many words, "If the body is evil, if the body is bad, then the incarnation is blasphemy." And he said to me, "Christ came into the world not to squash that desire, but to awaken it at its depth and redirect it towards the stars." And this is what Christianity is all about: launching us towards the stars. So I'd like to share, just in our remaining time, I'd like to share some of the main themes of this Theology of the Body. We only have about 40 minutes left together, so please be patient with me. I'm going to try to summarize 129 talks in the next 40 minutes. Are you ready? Let's just begin with this question. What makes the body theological? What an interesting expression, theology of the body. And I want to stress, theology of the body, it's delivered by a Catholic priest, but it's not just for Catholics. This is a reflection on the Bible. It's a reflection on creation and redemption and our heavenly destiny. This is a reflection on the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. This is nothing but a reflection on the Scripture. And this is why theology of the body is spreading wide and far, far beyond just Catholic borders. Let me share with you something that some evangelicals have said about the theology of the body. This is Dr. Greg Carter. He's an evangelical pastor who teaches the theology of the body to his students at Tyndale University College and Seminary. He says, "I predict that Protestants, especially evangelicals, will embrace the theology of the body in greater and greater numbers in the years ahead. Those who do will come to an understanding of sexual morality that is grounded in biblical revelation. If the church can recover that kind of sexual morality, then I think the church will be in the position to launch a new sexual revolution. A sexual revolution that returns to a biblical approach to human sexuality and the family." Christianity Today says of John Paul II's theology of the body that this brilliant theology can train evangelicals to approach creation, biology, gender, family, marriage in disciplined Christian ways. So I just want to share that. It's a gift from this Polish priest, but it's a gift meant for all believers. Indeed, for men and women of goodwill around the world. We have so many gifts to share with one another, don't we? I have been so enriched in my walk with the Lord from the gifts that the Holy Spirit has given my Protestant brothers and sisters, especially the evangelical movement. So enriched, so blessed. And I feel like I owe a debt of gratitude to give back. So I'm speaking more and more, not just in Catholic circles, but in evangelical circles as well. And it always blesses me to receive such a warm welcome. The Holy Spirit is doing something to bring us together, to show us that we have far more in common than anything that might divide us. Amen? Amen. So back to this question. What makes the body theological? You tell me. What makes the body a study of God? That's what theology is. Study of God. Theology of the body? Don't we tend to have the study of God over here and our bodies, especially our sexuality, over here? This phrase brings God and the body beautifully together. What justifies that? What allows us to do that from a biblical perspective? Which says,
"I will make them in my image."
Made in the image and likeness of God. Male and female, he made them. To say theology of the body is a synonym to being made in the image of God. We are used to an emphasis on the spiritual realm as Christians. We're not used to, and oftentimes, let's be honest, we are uncomfortable with an emphasis on the body. But that is a very un-Christian approach. It is a very unbiblical approach to the body, to be afraid of it, to think, no, we're supposed to live a spiritual life. Whoa. When St. Paul says to live by the Spirit and not by the flesh, he's not saying to reject our bodies. Who made our bodies? God made our bodies. And he looked at everything he made and said, "Behold, it is very good." To live by the Spirit does not mean we reject our bodies. It means we open our bodies to the indwelling of the Spirit. Because if the Spirit of the one who raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, the Spirit who gave life to Christ in his resurrection will also give life, Paul says, to your mortal body. Did you know it's impossible for the Bible to have heresy? Did you know that? It's a heresy to say spirit good, body bad. But we are riddled with this heretical thinking. It's sunken in. Maybe nobody ever came right out and said your body's bad, but it kind of hovers in the air, doesn't it? I mean, be honest with me. How many of you grew up thinking the spirit is the good and holy part of you, and the body is the not so holy part of you? Can I see a show of hands? Be honest. Look at the hands that went up here. when that is the message, we are soaking in lies that come from the pit of hell. There's a word for the separation of body and spirit. There's a word for the separation of body and soul. It's kind of a technical term, but maybe you've heard of it. It's called death. Have you heard of that one? Separation of body and soul is called death. Who's behind death? The father of lies. So who's behind the separation of body and soul? Could it be the father of lies? It is. Who's behind this idea that we're supposed to live a spiritual life divorced from our bodies? It's the father of lies. How do we recognize the Antichrist according to sacred scripture? He's the one who denies Christ come in the flesh. Any attack against the incarnation, any attack against the unity of body and soul, any attack against the unity of spirit and matter, any attack against the unity of theology and the body, of God and our body, any such attack, we know where it comes from. It comes from the father of lies. But we have soaked these lies in, and they have affected us very, very deeply. Little biblical quiz for you. Here we go. Biblical quiz. True or false? Man is a spiritual being. True or false? Man has a spiritual nature. I'm sorry. If you're thinking biblically, and we're using terms biblically, both are false. Or at least incomplete. And let me show why. Angels are spiritual beings, according to Scripture. What kind of beings are we, according to Scripture? Human beings. Did you know you're a human being? Angels have a spiritual nature, according to Scripture. What kind of nature do we have as human beings? Human nature. What is human nature, according to Scripture? Human nature is the marriage of the spiritual and the physical. Where do we see this? Right in Genesis. Created from the dust of the ground. That is not our physical nature. That is the physical aspect of our human nature. We don't have a physical nature and a spiritual nature. We have one nature. And our nature is called what? Human nature. And human nature is the marriage of the dust of the ground and the breath of God. Are you following me? That's human nature. Human nature is the marriage of body and soul. Satan's goal is always rupture, fracture, divorce. If you eat from that tree, you will expire. You will breathe out the life I've breathed in. That's always Satan's goal, for us to breathe out of our bodies the life that God breathed in. We were created inspired, filled with the... Our dust was filled with the Spirit, the breath of God. We were inspired. When we disobeyed God, we expired. It's called death. Separation of body and soul is called death. So, when our churches, and this is across denominational lines, Protestants, Catholics, Orthodox, we're all guilty here. When we are trying to live a spiritual life divorced from our bodies, what do we have in all of our churches when that's kind of the norm? We have a bunch of dead people. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 8 that what we cry for, what we groan for, what all of creation is yearning for is the redemption of the body. The redemption of the body. Christ came in the flesh, born of a woman. He came as a male, born of a female, to redeem masculinity and femininity. He came in the body to redeem the body. We are saved by His body and blood. Ours is an enfleshed, E-N, enfleshed faith. We must be very careful never to unflesh it, because when we unflesh it, that's always the work of whom? Of the enemy. How we doing? Can we keep going? There's more. There's always more. C.S. Lewis said it very well, brilliantly, in fact. Listen to this. This is from Mere Christianity. He says, I know some muddle-headed Christians have talked as if Christianity thought that sex or the body were bad in themselves, but they were wrong. Christianity is almost the only one of the great religions which thoroughly approves of the body, which believes that matter is good and that God Himself took on a body, and that some kind of body is going to be given to us even in heaven and is going to be an essential part of our eternal happiness. We believe in the resurrection of the body. Do we really believe in that? A lot of us don't really believe in that, I don't think, anymore. I mean, let's be honest here. I think we tend to think of heaven as where we are finally liberated from the prison of this physical world, don't we? That comes from the philosopher Plato. That doesn't come from Jesus Christ. Nothing of our human nature is deleted in heaven. It's always taken up and fully redeemed and fully completed in the resurrection. Lord, teach us to love our bodies. Teach us to love our sexuality. Teach us to love our erotic longings. Yes, they've gotten us in trouble. Yes, they've been misdirected by original sin. And yes, we have to wrestle and struggle. And yes, our body, because of sin that came into the world, our body is often a source of deep and profound suffering. But that doesn't mean we reject our bodies. It means we unite our sufferings with the sufferings of Christ. And those very sufferings in the body lead us to glory. Lord, teach us to love our bodies. Teach us the mystery of the incarnation. Teach us anew. Teach us anew the mystery of our creation as male and female. Teach us anew. Teach us anew the gift and original plan for erotic desire. And redirect our rocket engines towards the stars. Teach us anew. Teach us anew to hope in heaven, which is not some super spiritual reality where we're cut off from our bodies, but in the resurrection at the end of time, when you return in the flesh in your glorified body, we will hear the trumpet and we will be raised, and the dust to which we've returned will be gathered again, and your life will be breathed into that dust again, and we will become fully the men and women we are always destined to be. Give us hope, not in some super spiritual heaven, but give us hope in the resurrection of our bodies. Only this saves us from the fear of death. If the resurrection of the body is a fallacy, or if it never happened, if Christ was not raised bodily, what does Paul tell us? Your faith is futile. It's empty. If the resurrection is not real, if that eternal marriage feast that awaits us in heaven is not real, incarnate glory, incarnate ecstasy, incarnate participation in the eternal life of God, if that is not real, Paul says, forget it, just go for the fast food. Eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow we die. If the eternal banquet is not real, then the fast food is all we get. And if the fast food is all we get, put it this way, if the contest for this hunger we all feel is between the starvation diet and the fast food, who wins? Fast food, hands down. If the contest is between the fast food and the eternal wedding feast of the Lamb, where every ache and cry of the heart for love, union, fulfillment, and glory is fulfilled superabundantly and eternally, who wins? The wedding feast wins. So what does it mean to evangelize the world? It means, as Jesus Himself said, go out into the main streets and invite everyone to the wedding feast. That's the invitation. Why are our bodies theological? Because our bodies tell this story. What story? The divine story that we are destined for an ecstasy and a love and a union that lasts forever. What does what you're doing here have to do with the stars? There are three key words of Christ that we want to look at. This is what John Paul II does in the Theology of the Body. He looks at these three key words of Jesus that properly orient us. Very important word. Orient us. We live in a disoriented world. And when we are disoriented from God, precisely because our sexuality is imago Dei, image of God, when we are disoriented away from God, the fruit of that in our practical day-to-day lives is sexual disorientation. Do you know why Christians have traditionally always prayed to the east? Why have traditionally Christians prayed to the east? We need to put on our icon glasses and begin to recognize all of creation as an icon. You know what the fallout is of rejecting our bodies, of thinking we're supposed to live a spiritual life divorced from our bodies? The fallout of that whole Gnostic puritanical heresy, you know what it is? We start rejecting the whole physical world. We start thinking that we want to escape this world. And we no longer see creation as a sign that points us to the other world. We see it as something bad to reject, and we no longer know what the meaning of a sunrise is. What's the meaning of a sunrise? It's right in the Psalms. The sun comes forth from its tent like a bridegroom to give life to all of the earth, and nothing is concealed from its burning heat. Why does the church traditionally pray towards the rising of the sun? Because the church is the bride that's open to the coming of the bridegroom so that we can feel the burning heat. Someday, girl, I don't know when, we're going to get to that place where we really want to go, and we'll walk in the sun. The church prays to the east to be properly oriented. The Orient is what? The East. To be properly oriented, to see all of creation for what it is. Oh my gosh. Do you know what creation is? It's one big love song. It's one big love song. You can't study creation and conclude otherwise. God's favorite subject in all of creation is mating and fertility. It is. It is. In one square mile, there are more insects than there are human beings on the planet. And they have one mission. To eat and mate. That's all they're about. If we have our iconic glasses on, and by that I mean learning to read creation as an icon, and we're reading, what is God telling us through these more than 7 billion insects in every square mile that are just eating and mating? What is he trying to tell us? All of creation is a love story. It's a wedding feast. Eating and mating, it's a wedding feast. Where does Jesus perform his first miracle? At a wedding feast. How does the Bible end? A wedding feast. How does the Bible begin? In a garden where creation is mating and eating. Why are we put in a garden? Why are we put in a garden? Why are we put in a garden? What is a garden? Do you know what a flower is? Can we get an image of a flower up here? What is a flower? It's the reproductive organ of the plant. Do you know what we're doing when we give flowers to sick people? We're saying, here, let some of nature's beautiful reproductive organs cheer you up. What are the birds singing about? What are the birds singing about? What are the bees buzzing about? Take in a breath right now. Do you know what you just did? Chances are you just interrupted nature's mating process. Because floating through the air right now is what? Pollen. Do you know what pollen is? Millions upon millions upon millions upon millions of seeds looking for flowers. Looking for a mate so that they might be fruitful and multiply. It is a sign, if we are reading creation as an icon, all of creation is a sign that God is life-giving love. Our bodies, as male and female, tell this story, that God is life-giving love. Do you know what the word gender actually means? Look at the root. Gender, generosity, genitals. You know what's in the middle of generosity? Eros. Generosity. The word gender means the manner in which you generate. Men generate by giving the seed. Women generate by opening to receive the seed and conceive new life within. Gender means the manner in which you generate, which is another way of saying the manner in which you image God's life-giving love. This makes the study of human sexuality not only biology, but theology. The study of God. So let's go to the three key words of Christ. Three key words of Christ that build the foundation of this theology of the body. We've lost sight of this. We've lost sight of how we are part of God's love story. We've lost sight of how what happened to my flower? Can we keep up that flower? We've lost sight of how our bodies tell this story. And Jesus comes in the flesh, a male born of a female, to tell again this story of male and female. To redeem masculinity and femininity. To redeem the body. To redirect our rocket engines towards the stars. We're all familiar when the Pharisees come to Jesus, Matthew chapter 19. They question Jesus about divorce. They say, Moses allowed us to divorce our wives. What do you say, Jesus? Jesus says, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives because of the hardness of your hearts. But from the beginning, it was not so. From the beginning, it was not so. Jesus is pointing us back to the beginning. The beginning is the norm. We've fallen from it. The beginning is the norm. This is what the world doesn't understand. The world today has normalized the fall. And you know what? A lot of us as Christians do too. God made me this way. What way? Haven't you read? Listen to how these words of Christ. He is the Savior. He comes to redeem the body. His first miracle is at a wedding. He comes to redeem and restore eros. He comes to restore the original generosity of His love in our bodies. We have lost that generosity. We've lost it through original sin. He comes to restore it. The Pharisees in their own self-righteousness come. Is it okay for us to divorce? Is it okay for us not to be generous with our wives? Is it okay for us to abandon our wives? This is not to undermine the real friction, real pain, real heartache. Sometimes separation of bed and board is a duty. To save someone from a terrible abusive situation, none of this is undermined. But Christ wants to... What's this network called? Christ wants to restore hope that we can, by His grace, return to the original order. Haven't you read that in the beginning, God made them male and female? The Savior just cut through all the confusion of the modern world with those words. Are you following me? Go onto Facebook. A year ago, if you went on Facebook, over 50 gender options to choose from in your personal profile. There were complaints that there weren't enough. And so they just reduced it to three now. Male, female, and custom. Okay, God makes us male and female. What does that custom indicate? You will be like God. You can customize your gender. You can custom. You can custom. Do you hear the temptation of the liar there? You will be like God. You can recreate yourself. Listen to Christ's words. These are saving words. These are not words of condemnation. No one is condemned here. Everyone is saved if we would but open to receive these words. Haven't you read that in the beginning, God made them male and female and called the two to become one flesh? You know what? Let's be compassionate. A lot of people haven't heard that. A lot of people haven't heard that. So Christ points us back to the beginning. John Paul II, in his Theology of the Body, follows these words of Christ and goes back to Genesis to reflect on God's original plan. And I want to summarize what he has to say to us by giving you a visual here. Some of you may have seen me do this on YouTube before. If you have, just pretend you haven't. Imagine, if you will, that this is the most beautiful painting you have ever seen in your life. Do I hear some oohs? Do I hear some ahs? Thanks for playing. What is this a painting of? Now, we've all had, I imagine, the experience of seeing something in God's creation that's pierced the heart because of its beauty. Anybody here seen the double rainbow guy on YouTube? This is a great, yes, a few of you. This is a great example of someone who is pierced by beauty. He walks out of his house, he sees this double rainbow, and he's just like hit with a dart. He starts to moan and grow. Actually, I think we have it. Can we pull it up? Let's take a look at the double rainbow guy. The purpose of showing this video.
Oh, that's a full rainbow.
Pause a sec. The purpose of showing this video is, I hope, to give us the courage again to feel beauty and the power of beauty. Open our hearts and our deepest longings. Let's take a look.
All the way. Double rainbow. Oh my God. It's a double rainbow all the way. Whoa, that's so intense. Whoa, man. Wow. Whoa. Whoa. Whoa! Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh my God! Woo! Oh my! Wow! Woo! Yeah! Oh my! Oh my! Oh my God! Look at that! It's starting to even look like a triple rainbow. Oh my God, it's full on. Double rainbow all the way across the sky. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh God. What does this mean? Oh. Oh my God. Oh. Oh God. It's so bright. Oh my God. It's so bright and vivid. Oh.
This was very popular on YouTube about 5 years ago. I think it has like 350 million views. I think 2 million of those views come from me. Because whenever I'm down, I just watch the double rainbow guy. He was invited on all the talk shows, and the first question out of all the hosts were you on drugs? What was going on? You know what he said? He said, no, I was not on drugs. Well, what's the lesson of all this? He said, the lesson is you can just get high on God's beauty. You can get high on God's beauty. But what is more beautiful than any double rainbow? What is more beautiful than any starlit night? What is more beautiful than any flower or snow peak mountaintop? What is the crown of creation? That's what this painting is. What is the crown? We are. This is a painting of what Christ pointed us to back in the beginning, when man and woman were naked and felt no shame. There is nothing more beautiful in all of God's creation than the naked human body. Nothing. Now, we should look at this painting with the same kind of awe and wonder that this guy expressed in seeing the double rainbow. And the two paintings, the double rainbow and the image of God in man and woman, they're actually related. What was the sign that God gave to Noah? The rainbow. He said, God said, this is the sign of the covenant between heaven and earth. This is the sign of the covenant between heaven and earth. Whenever you hear covenant in Scripture, you can substitute it with marriage. The covenant God wants to establish between heaven and earth is a marital covenant. He has espoused Himself to us forever, Scripture says. So we should look with the same awe and wonder, and we should cry out as He did. Whenever you're pierced by beauty, the question that gets aroused in the heart is, what does it mean? What does it mean that we are made male and female? Why are there two sexes? Oh my gosh, this question could not be more significant in our world today. Why are there two sexes? Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 5, this is a great mystery, and it refers to Christ and the church. Right from the beginning, this is a sign of God's covenant that would be fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Right from the beginning, the call of the man and the woman to holy communion is a foreshadowing of the call of Christ and the church to holy communion. They were naked without shame because they saw in each other's nakedness this mystery revealed. They saw in each other's nakedness something theological. From beginning to end, the Bible tells a story of marriage. It begins with this painting. Throughout the Old Testament, God speaks of His love for His people as the love of a husband for his bride. In the New Testament, the love of the eternal bridegroom is literally embodied when the Word is made flesh. Skip to the end of the story. The book of Revelation describes heaven. How? How? As a wedding feast, as a wedding feast, as a wedding feast, as a wedding feast. Who gets married in heaven? We do. To whom? To Christ. Christ and the church experience an eternal union of love that the Bible describes as a marriage. God wanted this eternal marital plan to be so plain to us, so obvious to us, that He stamped an image of it right in our bodies. Theology of the body. When we read the language of human sexuality properly, what we see is an icon. This is an icon of heaven. What does what you're doing here have to do with the stars? We can summarize the whole Bible in five words based on the theology of the body. Are you ready? Five words to summarize the whole Bible. God wants to marry us. This is the main icon. This is the main sign. More significant than a rainbow, this is the sign of the covenant. Whenever a covenant is established between God and His people, whenever a covenant is established between God and His people in the Bible, you will always see the call to be fruitful and multiply. Why? Because that generosity written into our bodies, may I be more specific, written into our genitals, written into our gender, that call to generosity is the main icon in the created world of the eternal mystery of the life-giving God. The God who is not a solitude, the God who is a family, an eternal exchange of life-giving love, Father, Son, and Spirit. We image that life-giving love in our creation as male and female. Satan has one goal, to keep us from heaven. The Scripture says that the fallen angels, Lucifer and all who followed him, they fell out of envy. Why did they fall out of envy? What do they envy? What do we have that the angels don't have? Bodies. Bodies that participate in the eternal life of God. Satan fall out of envy. And when you envy something, you don't just want it for yourself. You don't want the person who has it to have it. So what is Satan's goal from the beginning? To separate us from our bodies. It's called what? Death. That's why he aims all his arrows at this painting. What happened to this painting with original sin? Terribly twisted and distorted. This is when the rocket engines became inverted. And this is when Eros became lust. Remember these words of Jesus. In the beginning it was not so. In the beginning it was not so. Second key word of Jesus comes from the Sermon on the Mount. You've heard the commandment not to commit adultery, but the commandment's not enough. Just following the rules isn't enough. Think of the rich young man. Following the rules isn't enough. You've heard the commandment not to commit adultery, but I say to you that if you even look lustfully, you've already committed adultery in your heart. Christ is after our hearts. This is an image of our hearts right here. Our hearts have gotten all hardened and crumpled up and twisted and distorted because we don't know who we are anymore. We don't know who we are anymore. And here is the classic religious blunder, the classic spiritual mistake. Spiritual people look at this crumpled up, lustful, distorted paper, and what does it look like? Trash. So what do we think the solution is? Throw it away. And a lot of us grow up thinking spirit good, body bad, but that's the Gnostic, Manichaean, puritanical heresy. We're still separated from our bodies. Two men in the 20th century, both very prominent figures of the 20th century, reached into this trash can and pulled this out and started telling the modern world we mustn't throw this away. One man's name was Hugh Hefner, founder of Playboy magazine and one of the main architects of the sexual revolution. In the early 1950s, when he started Playboy magazine, he said, "I started this magazine as my personal response to the hurt and hypocrisy of Puritanism in my Christian upbringing." He says, "I was raised in a very strict Methodist home. I learned all the rules, but there was no affection in my family, and sex was taboo. Nobody talked about it. There was no hugging or kissing in my family." Hugh Hefner says, "When I talk about the hypocrisy in our sexual values, it comes from the fact that I didn't get hugged a lot as a kid." Now, Hugh Hefner can't just chalk off what he's done here as "I didn't get hugged." Sin is real, right? And there's something so distorted in our humanity that we can actually be really fascinated and attracted by darkness. At the same time, it does give us a window that we can have compassion on Hugh Hefner and all who have followed him. And I would guess most of us in here have followed him. Why have we followed him? Because the fast food is more attractive than the starvation. That's why we followed him. Was Hugh Hefner right to tell the modern world we mustn't throw this away? He was right on that point. Where was he wrong? And dreadfully wrong. He left it just like this, in its distorted, twisted up form. And he said to the modern world, "Don't you want to look at this? Don't you want to look at this?" And he directed our yearning for the stars towards something finite. And 60 years later, we are now a culture not of sexual liberation, but of sexual addiction. Remember the theological definition of addiction. But how do we evangelize the world? We study the idol. And we show the world what the world is really looking for. This is exactly what the theology of the body is. Right at the same time, Hugh Hefner started Playboy magazine, early 1950s. This young Polish priest named Karol Wojtyła also pulled this out of the trash can and started saying to the modern world, "You mustn't throw this away." But he did something Hugh Hefner didn't do. Reflecting deeply on these key words of Jesus, we've already talked about two of them, where Jesus points us back to the beginning, where Jesus talks about the distortion of lust, but calls us to the resurrection of the body. That's the third key word. Where Jesus says, in the resurrection, men and women are no longer given in marriage. What? We get to heaven and God just pushes the delete button on our sexuality? He pushes the complete button. Because which one of these bookends of the Bible? The Bible begins with the marriage of man and woman. The Bible ends with the marriage of Christ and the church. Which one of these marriages is infinite? Christ and the church. In other words, which one of these marriages is possible of satisfying eros at its depth? We're made for an eternal union. So John Paul II's Theology of the Body, based on this redemption and resurrection of our humanity, he started uncrumpling for us the original, beautiful, wonderful iconography of God so that we could see again who we really are. And we could recognize this as an icon that points us to the infinite. An icon that if we ponder it with those proper lenses, which Scripture calls purity of heart. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. If we ponder this, and purity of heart is only a grace, we can't muster it up, we can't pull ourselves up by our bootstraps, we have to surrender all of our broken humanity to the Lord. And as we give this broken humanity to the Lord, as we orient ourselves towards the Lord, what does the sun do when we're properly oriented? What does the sun do? It opens the flower. And we rediscover who we are. And we realize this is not what we're really even looking for. This is just the icon of what we're looking for. And if you're called to married life, rejoice. Live it as an icon that gets you to heaven. If you're not called to marriage, guess what? Rejoice. Because this marriage is not what you're really looking for. What you're really looking for is the marriage of the Lamb, and that is already granted to you as a sure promise. The Holy Spirit's the first deposit. We are destined to last forever. How do we know this? Our bodies tell the story. I close with this. It's all in Ephesians chapter 5, which John Paul calls the teaching of Paul a summary of the whole Bible. You looking for a summary of the whole Bible? Here it is. Paul quotes from Genesis and links it with Revelation when he says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh." This is a great mystery. And it refers to Christ and the church. Christ left his father in heaven. He left the home of his mother on earth to give up his body for his bride, so that we, the bride of Christ, might become one in the flesh with him. It's called the marriage of the Lamb. Lord, Lord, redirect our desire according to your design so we can reach our destiny. Redirect our rocket engines towards the stars. Reorient us towards the eternal light of the sun. Whoa, oh, 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 whoa, oh, 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 whoa, 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 oh, 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 oh. May the Word made flesh be praised now and ever and forever. Amen.